It means everything in the world to a person that has nowhere to go, to have immediate access, to immediate access to a place that they can call home, a place out of the cold, a place that's not only open when it's 20 degrees or less, but a place that's open year round. And that's what New Life Evangelistic Center provides. Because of those of you that are caring and sharing, be sure you stay tuned. I'm Larry Rice, and this is Here's Help. What a blessing it is that New Life Evangelistic Center is able to provide immediate access to people when they're hurting, working to be there when people are hurting. And now it's been 43 years since the work of New Life Evangelistic Center started. And it continues day after day, without city, state, or federal dollars, or even United Way dollars, but caring people linking up with the New Life Evangelistic Center who truly care about their fellow human beings, who care whether they have a place to sleep inside and not be out in the cold and freeze, who care whether or not they get a second chance to break the cycle of homelessness, immediate access. And that's what is happening. When people are hurting, they continue to have a place to stay at the New Life Evangelistic Center, both at 1411 Locust Street and a wide range of other locations throughout Mid-America, because of each one of you that are caring and sharing. How I thank God for those of you that are providing that immediate access by becoming Club 24 members. It's only 80 cents a day, $24 a month. Are sharing that special gift now with New Life Evangelistic Center at P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri. That's 63166. Have with me one man that's happy that you had immediate access. You were able to come to New Life. You found yourself homeless. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Tell everyone your name.
Charles Nixon.
Charles, how important is it to you that you had that immediate access, that you were able to get a New Life at your time of need?
It was pretty important to me, both physically and emotionally.
Because you were going through some really hard times, weren't you?
Yes, sir.
And the fact that doors were open to you made a big difference in your life?
It was probably one of the only safe doors open to me.
And we have to keep that safe door open. And I thank God for those who are standing side by side with New Life at this particular time. As we're encountering, trials and tribulations, we're encountering the hostilities of those that are often in power. Why would the St. Louis Post-Dispatch write a series of negative editorials or publish a column by a previous editor by the name of Eddie Roth? Well, Eddie Roth is now head of Health and Human Services for the city of St. Louis. The mayor's pretty shrewd. He's hiring the editors over at the newspaper, and he's getting a lot of positive press in the meantime. And sure, they're taking us to task. But I believe that God's people can see through all of this stuff. I think that God's people can see and know what the facts are. When they print half-truths, lies, innuendos, come up with fabricated stories like New Life is worth $40 to $50 million, which is absolutely ridiculous. Are they assessing the value of KNLC Channel 24? It's nothing like that. Doesn't even have any ad revenue. It's just a voice for those that are considered nuisance because they're poor and needy. Well, we can cut through all of this, knowing what truth is, by getting directly involved among the hurting and homeless. And that's the invitation we give you here at New Life Evangelistic Center. And we're determined to keep this place open, because if it had been closed to you, it could have been disastrous.
Very.
And not only him, but so many more. I thank God for those who are speaking up and speaking out in behalf of New Life at this particular time.
Hello, I'm Bernie Hayes. With me is Lydia Douglas. She's a motivational speaker and an author, and also a longtime supporter of the New Life Evangelistic Center. Ms. Douglas, how are you?
I'm just fine. How are you?
Tell us about the importance of giving back and helping, especially since you've been helping the New Life Evangelistic Center for so long. How's it make you feel, and why do you do it?
It's a good feeling. I'm doing what the Word of God told me to do. He said, I was hungry and you fed me not. You know, so all the things that the Word of God told me to do, when I know this, then I am supposed to go out and do it. Mm-hmm. And I feel really good. It's a good feeling to be able to help someone along the way. And this is a very, very good program. It really is. Mm-hmm. I don't feel envious or jealousy or anything. I give it from my heart. Mm-hmm. And when we do that, then God is pleased.
What's the importance of giving? How does it make you feel inside and your heart?
It makes me feel good, mm-hmm. because then I am doing what God has told me to do. And when I do that, then He is pleased with the work that I'm doing. Mm-hmm. When we learn the Word, we need to put some action behind it. He said, I was sick and you visited me not. A phone call, let's go and visit the ones. See, we are where we are today, but it could be our day tomorrow. So let's reach out and help others when we can. And I guarantee you, God will open the doors of the windows of heaven and pour you out blessings that you will not have room to receive. So let's help the people. And I really do feel good when I do that, because
some
I'm doing
people,
it from my heart.
The people who are in need, a lot of people think that they choose to be homeless. A lot of people think they choose to be on the street. A lot of people think they choose to be poor. But you don't look down on those people, do you?
No, I don't. And then who am I to judge? Mm-hmm. I don't know how or why they ended up homeless. I am just to do what God has told me to do. Mm-hmm. I am not to judge anyone.
Okay. The New Life Evangelistic Center, they have a homeless shelter, and there are some people who actually want to close this shelter. They don't want to take the license away from Reverend Larry Rice and his assistants and pastors and associates and so forth. How do you feel? Tell us in your heart the need to keep that shelter going.
When I hear that, mm-hmm. that touches my heart. It touches my heart, because the ones that want to close the shelter, take the license away, how do you feel? That could be you or your family members, you know? Mm-hmm. So let's help the ones that are not in the position that we're in. Mm-hmm. Just reach out and help them. Mm-hmm. And I don't see a need to close the shelter. I really don't. Mm-hmm. These people need some place. We have a roof over our head. Let's support a roof over these people's head. Mm-hmm. You know, the weather is changing, so let's just support them.
Thank you, Bernie and Lydia. You have no idea of the hurt and the pain that many of the people who come to our doors are going through. Tell everyone your name again.
Charles Nixon.
And Charles, in your case, your wife was murdered. Your unborn
child. My fiance.
Died. And you, that was devastating to you, and you ended up without any place at all. You've ended up actually sleeping outside, is that correct?
Yes, sir, it is.
Could you have froze to death? Could you have died out there if New Life had not opened its doors?
Well, the day my wife and an unborn child were murdered, I walked in on it. And even at the end of it, I was taken down to homicide and was not allowed back into my own home because it was a crime scene. And it's been like that since June the 5th of 14.
We could share with you so many stories of so many individuals that have encountered so many situations And that's why we're continuing to keep New Life Evangelistic Center open. It looks like it's all going to federal court. But last time we went to federal court concerning the city of St. Louis, New Life Evangelistic Center prevailed. Because in that case, Mr. Eddie Roth, who was head of public safety at that time, didn't take into consideration how New Life was a church and had a right to continue to preach. We tried to stop us from preaching and stop us from reaching out and helping the people at 44 in Vandeventer. I was locked up, went to federal court, and through the mediation process, New Life got its legal expenses covered by the city of St. Louis, plus they had to drop all the charges against me and gave us the right to use the ground. But the same thing, 1411 Locust is a church where New Life has its church. And we believe that the provision of shelter is a function of worship. So now we're moving in to the federal court system. But in the meantime, I really thank God for those of you that are able to cut through all the stuff that's being said and all these things that people are trying to do to stop us. And continue to stand with us in solidarity. I praise God for all of you that are letting your voice be heard. I want to go back to Bernie at this time.
Howard, Reverend Larry Rice and so many others here at the New Life Evangelistic Center, they talk in part of it. They try to fulfill a need in the spiritual body also. Mm-hmm. And Howard, for those who don't have education, how should they feel? Is there still hope for them? Is there hope that they can come here at the New Life Evangelistic Center or even follow you and then become better people or feel better about themselves?
We are made in the likeness of the Creator, the big guy.
Sure.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And that makes us little creators. And the neat thing about being human, being created, if you will, by God, is that we can wake up any morning and decide to recreate ourselves. What organizations like the New Life Evangelistic Center are so absolutely terrific at is being willing to reach out to the least of these, if you will, you know, to those that are really down and out and resources have been exhausted and don't even know where they're going to lay their head for the night or where they're going to get the next meal. And by ministering to them, validate their worth. And by taking care of their basic needs while they really go through a spiritual transformation. Mm-hmm. That allows them to then reenter society and to navigate life successfully. I mean, what would we do without New Life? Mm-hmm. You know, who would fill that void?
Sure.
There are so many people that would literally be on the streets if they weren't able to spend the night here, you know?
And they should not feel bad about themselves because they're in that position, you're saying?
You know, it's not enough jobs. Mm-hmm. Okay, so somebody's going to be unemployed, somebody's going to lose their home, somebody's going to need a hot meal.
Sure.
You know, when we as a society decide that that's not okay, then New Life won't be dependent on donations, if you know what I mean.
Sure.
I mean, when we as a society decide that as a rich nation, it's ridiculous that we have people that are hungry, and we have so many people that are hungry. It's ridiculous that we have people living on the street.
Yeah.
But until then, we desperately need the New Lives.
Mm-hmm. You know, we're here at the 1411 Locust Street in downtown St. Louis, Missouri, and there are some people in close proximity to the New Life Evangelistic Center who want to see it disappear. And New Life is in a terrible fight right now in a lawsuit just to maintain its hotel license so they can house the homeless.
Right.
And just getting your feeling about that, how do you feel about people who don't want to see the homeless? Instead of concentrating on the right. nightclubs on Washington right. Avenue, instead of concentrating right. on the bad elements of the area, they're concentrating on the New Life Evangelistic right. Center and want to see it right. go away, at least its right. hotel license go away.
Yeah, help me understand something, mm-hmm. Bernie.
Sure.
For how many years has New Life been housing people here?
38 years. In this location, then. 42 years in the city itself.
Okay, 38, yeah. 42 years. Yeah. Okay, and it certainly is not a for-profit.
Not at all.
Okay.
No, no United Way funds, no government funds, no federal grants, nothing. Right. All donations from the our okay. viewers.
So yeah. let me make sure I get this right.
Yeah.
Okay. Caring people in the community.
Yeah.
For 38 years.
Yeah,
have
least.
Given
42
their,
years,
actually. 42 years.
In the community,
have
yeah.
given their funds.
Yeah.
So that there is a place of last resort, so yes. that there is a place where someone can come with their little girl and not have to try to spend the night on the street and stay safe, where they can come and get a meal and not have to go diving in a dumpster. This has been going on for 38 years.
42
years because of the good people in this community.
Right.
And somebody has woken up and decided that it doesn't have a right to be here?
Yes, yes, yes.
They're out on the street, many of them who are sick, many of them are hurting, many are homeless. My next guest came to us. He's got a pretty bad cold, is that correct?
Yes, it is.
Tell us your name.
Samuel Mitchell.
Samuel, did you have to sleep out on those streets?
Yes, I slept in cars and vacant houses.
Wow, couldn't find any other place to go?
Couldn't find nowhere else to go, no.
How important is it that people support the work of New Life Evangelistic Center and we keep the building open here?
That is very important, especially to me.
Is it really?
Yes, it is.
How is it helping you?
It's helping. I'm not out in the cold. I could eat and shower. And
if you were left out in the cold, could you have froze to death out there?
Very much so, yes.
Now, I know that the city will open its place, and they'll open a couple warming centers out in the county if the high for the day is 20 degrees, but wow, you wouldn't leave a dog out there when it's the high is 30 degrees.
Oh,
why would they leave human beings out there?
Right, that's true. That's true. That's true. I couldn't. I don't see how they would want to close you down.
They don't want you and other people that don't have any money in the neighborhood. They want to drive you out because you're poor. They consider you a nuisance.
Right. Yes. Sure do.
I sure thank God for those that are praying right now and supporting this work.
Yes.
Don't you?
Yes, I do.
Every one of you are an answer to prayer. Every one of you that are writing that much-needed tax-deductible gift, sending it to New Life Evangelistic Center. New Life's about to celebrate its 43rd anniversary, 43 years being on the front lines, working to be there when people are hurting. Why don't you share a gift of $43 or maybe $86 or different components thereof like that for every year New Life's been there? $1 a year? $2 a year? Wow. Your gift just makes such a big difference at this time. New Life receives no city, state, or federal dollars or United Way dollars. It comes to the people and say, here's a way that you can come get directly involved, avoid the middleman or middlewoman, and just really connect with people that are hurting and in need and help save lives. That's what you're doing when you're sharing with New Life Evangelistic Center. It's P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri. That's 63166. I want to say thank you to each one of you that are doing your part and sharing at this time. It's very, very important, and in the way you sound, it could have saved your life.
Really, yes. I appreciate what they're doing, and God bless them all.
How did you end up losing your place?
I caught pneumonia. I had walking pneumonia, and I was in the hospital from the end of December of 13 until the end of March of 2014, and when I got out, I wasn't able to go back to work, and I couldn't pay any bills.
You know? Could happen to anybody, couldn't it?
It could, yes. It happened to me, so yes, it can.
And that's why we need to keep New Life Evangelistic Center open,
yes,
don't
yes,
we?
Yes, that's correct. Yes.
And we need your help in keeping it open. It's New Life Evangelistic Center, P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri. That's 63166. I really thank God for all of you that are supporting New Life at this time because your prayers and gifts are so very much needed. You're an answer to prayer in so many different ways. And again, I thank those from throughout the community that are standing with us at this moment and encouraging people to get directly involved. Let's go back to Bernie Hayes.
My guest is Reddick Hudson. Reddick Hudson is a very well-known activist in the St. Louis area, and I'd like to welcome you to the New Life Evangelistic Center, Mr. Hudson.
I'm glad to be here.
You've been here before. In fact, it's so good seeing you. You were with the ACLU for a while.
Yes, I was with the ACLU. Now I'm with the NAACP. I work for the national NAACP as a regional field organizer, Region 4, 10 states in the Midwest. I'm enjoying that. I'm still learning on the job. I started last August. And as you know, historically, the NAACP has been a major player in terms of advancing the rights of everyone, but in particular, African Americans.
And Reddick, I understand you ran for the school board.
Yeah, St. Louis Community College Board of Trustees.
Yeah, and you had some money left over, and that money, what did you do with it?
Well, I'll tell you, I had money left over from the campaign.
Yes, sir.
And in light of recent events relative to campaign finance and problems that some of my colleagues have had, I wanted to be very intentional about making sure that I made that money go to nothing that was connected to me in any way, shape, sure. or form. Mm-hmm. There would be no question that I got rid of it. So I gave the money to Larry Rice. New Life Evangelistic Center. Yeah, because I've always, and I mean always, deeply appreciated the work of this organization and the mission of this organization. When you see, as we just talked about a moment ago, families now out here on these streets, man, children as young as 2, 3, sometimes infants that don't have a place to live, food to eat, clothes to wear. I was glad to give what remained from my campaign fund to this New Life Evangelistic Center. And I hope that it goes to people who need it immediately, and I know that it will.
Rudy, can you imagine your family being homeless?
Oh, man.
Tell us about
it. You know, I know that anything is possible, and I know that for so many people, I was having this conversation with someone just the other day, that it's hard out here, man. It is hard out here. Even people who appear to be successful or who appear to be doing well, in many cases, are a paycheck away or two paychecks away or a bad circumstance away from being in very different conditions.
Sure.
And the idea of not having a place for my family or anyone's family to live, a shelter, food and clothes, it's devastating. And you would think that people would have the kind of compassion that we espouse, you know, people of faith espouse, people who are believers espouse. But at the same time, you see so much pushback, so much resistance to the efforts of places like this to help people who are obviously in need, a desperate need.
When you study the scriptures, you see over and over how close it is to the heart of God to provide hospitality, to provide an opportunity for His love to flow. Hospitality is a critical part of the message of the scriptures, of all of Judeo-Christian thought and belief. We see Abraham and the two Abraham welcoming the three visitors that come and see him and when he gets the announcement that he's going to be a father. We see the whole teaching of the Exodus and how God reminds in Deuteronomy his people to provide for those that are in need in the same way that they were provided for miraculously as they went through the wilderness onto the promised land. We see Jesus totally and completely identifying with the homeless unlike any others. So clearly, when he said that foxes have holes and birds have nests, but he, the Son of Man, had nowhere to lay his head. And he said, when I was hungry, did you feed me? Naked, did you clothe me? Sick or in prison, you visit me. A stranger, did you welcome me? Do you have any idea what it is to wander as a refuge and just find yourself without any place? Did you have any idea what it was like when you lost your home?
No, I didn't.
You lost it?
Yes, I lost it. What was the apartment, you know, but I lost it. Ooh.
And when you lose your apartment and you got a severe cold like you do,
right.
It can be devastating, can't it?
Yes, it can. Yes, it can. I know it's about to run out.
People are hurting, brothers and sisters. They're leaving them out on the street. They're in need out there. And I'm asking you to understand and let Christ's light and love flow through you now that you might let your light so shine before men and women. They may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. People are sick out there. People are hurting out there. And then for them to give an order, December 23rd, the Board of Public Service, that we can't, that we have to cut from 300 to 32 and put them out on the street. Something's wrong in all that. It's sad and it's sick. But New Life Evangelistics is determined to continue to be there when people are hurting. And I thank God for those who are letting the love and compassion of Christ flow through them.
Hello, it's not only hard for the men, but it's hard for the women like me. My name is Angela Ketcherside.
Angela, you found yourself homeless.
Mm-hmm.
Can you describe how it is hard?
It's scary. It's scary to be out here on the street by yourself and be a female. And that's without the weather being bad. That's on an average day, it's scary.
And what if New Life had not been there for you?
Then I would be sleeping in a park.
They say you can't be out there after 10 o'clock at night.
Then I guess they would take me to jail because that's where I'd be. I have nowhere else to go.
How did you end up losing your place, Andrew?
I had a place in Ferguson. It was expensive. I couldn't afford it. I came down here. I was here for a couple of months. I left here thinking I could go stay with somebody. Turned out to be a bad environment. And so I came back.
So keeping this place open on an ongoing basis is critical.
It's important.
Mm-hmm. Now, where we're at on all this is the city's made its order December the 23rd, hand-picked board of public service. The board picked by the mayor's office, they had their mind made up. They were going to do this, okay? But we are still waiting to get their written order. Once we get the written order, our attorneys immediately go to work, and this becomes a federal court issue. It's just beginning the whole process. Federal court issue because they're dealing with the church. And what they did is they said that they want to revoke or limit our hotel permit to 32 people. We're not a hotel. New Life Evangelistic Center has never been a hotel at 1411 Locust Street. So again, why does a church need a hotel permit to fulfill its function of worship? That's what the federal courts are going to have to decide. They're going to start imposing laws that you can't keep people in church after 2 o'clock in the afternoon or even 10 o'clock at night. If churches say, look, the people that came to service here don't have a place to stay, and I'm going to let them sleep on the pews, is the city going to dictate what a church is going to do and not do? They tried to do that in New York City in a recent case, saying that when the church wanted to allow people to sleep on its steps, and the city said you can't sleep on its steps. They went to federal court. The city won the right, the church won the right for the people to sleep on the steps. I mean, churches have an opportunity at this moment to stand up and be counted. And so as a result, it's much bigger than just New Life Evangelistic Center. It involves churches all over. Can churches follow the mandates of Scripture in spite of what local municipalities might say? And we believe that Jesus has told us that when women find themselves on the street, find themselves homeless, our men, the sick, the elderly, the handicapped, little children, we're supposed to take them in. Now, because the mayor's office and downtown business interests don't want those kind of people, the homeless, those that don't have money, and they consider them nuisance, are we supposed to then do what they say? Well, the editorial staff for the Post-Dispatch, where Mr. Eddie Roth, who's head of human service for the city, accuses me of not being a good neighbor because I won't put this lady and others back out on the street. My response is open up a number of shelters in St. Louis County. So I don't have to come from Ferguson to downtown St. Louis. Open shelters in other parts of the city. And if you do, and more people go to those, then less will be coming down here. It's as simple as that. But to give an edict, an order that we can't take people in that are knowingly coming to our doors because they don't have anywhere else to go, and then expect us to follow that order, knowing what they're going to have to go through rather than what Jesus told us to do, is a violation of everything we believe in that we refuse to do. And that's why we're having this particular problem, is because we're not compromising with them, and we're not giving in to them. So they write letters to the columns in the newspaper, and the editorial staff over there makes it look like I'm not a good neighbor and makes it look like I'm not going along with the crowd like all those other members of the Continuum of Care are. Continuum of Care is a city a group of agencies that get money from the city. And then if they don't do what the city tells them to do, they can cut off their money. Threat perhaps was given to Salvation Army. For whatever reason, they stopped taking homeless people in at 3010 Washington. Our St. Patrick's Center do a lot of good during the day, but they don't shelter them at night. So when push comes to shove, you end up, this is the only place you have left to come to.
This is a safe place I can come to.
Have you slept outside before?
Months ago.
What was it like?
It was scary. I had my son with me.
How old is he?
Six.
6 years old. Mm-hmm. And he was with you and you were sleeping out there?
Mm-hmm.
And he was pretty scared? Mm-hmm. Tell us about the frightening experiences. Why was it scary?
Because you don't know who's going to walk up on you or walk up by you or anything. You're out in the open.
And this is why we're fighting so hard. So let them write what they will and let them say what they will. But I've got to be concerned about what God tells me to do, and what the Scriptures tell me to do, and so should you. I need you to join us, brothers and sisters, at this time in ongoing, earnest prayer. I need you just to go to God and pray for myself and the rest of us here at New Life Evangelistic Center. I'm asking you to stand with us in faith and share a much-needed gift now for our legal expenses with the New Life Evangelistic Center at P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, that's 63166. And I want to say thank you to those of you who are doing that. Thank you for those of you who are letting your voice be heard. Thank you to all of you at this time that are letting the light and love of Christ flow through you and are helping us to continue to provide a place for those who have no other place to go.